I'd like to start off though by doing an acknowledgement of country. We are meeting on stolen land, the land of the Gadigal people, and sovereignty was never ceded, and an oppressed nation of people continue to fight for their decolonization whilst living in a racist system and enduring continued attacks from a systematically racist government. So what is the Syrian endgame and how do we understand it? The speakers will be presenting you with the information that will provide you with a counter to the imperialist propaganda that we see about this conflict almost every day now. The media narratives, for example, would have us believe that there is no solidified imperialist and anti-imperialist stance, that if NATO is not warranted in its actions, then at least all state actors are to blame. And of course, leaving us, the average citizen of a country with political loyalties to NATO, with the very dangerous conclusion that there is no side in this war. The past year of conflict and even the past 5 years of conflict has brought out of the woodshed political divisions that don't rest simply within the Pentagon, but also within the organized political left. Of course, with recent events and information leaked or given freely and the dust now beginning to settle in certain areas of Syria, the mainstream populace are beginning to see the cracks in this narrative. So I'd like to introduce you to our first speaker. The history of Syria from the state's deshackling of French colonial rule to the country's long-standing labour movements and then the eventual rise of the Ba'ath Party provide us with greater insight into the civil war we see being played out today. And to tell us more about that, I'd like to welcome a proud Syrian and activist, Sam Saadat.
Can you hear me okay? So thank you very much for the introduction. So before I begin, I also would like to acknowledge country and pay respect to the traditional owners of the land on which we meet, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and it is upon their ancestral grounds that the Sydney University was built. I would also like to pay my respect to elders past and present, and extend that respect to any other Indigenous Australian or Aboriginal person present with us today. Also, I cannot begin without acknowledging the brave men, women and children of Syria, and especially those who have suffered the ultimate sacrifice over the past 5 years, and I extend my deepest condolences and respect to those Syrians who are suffering, who have suffered and who have lost. I am Syrian by birth. I am obviously an Australian citizen, as you can tell by my accent. I do live in Sydney, and I'm a lawyer by profession, so hence the suit today, straight from work into Sydney University. A bit of background, I was born in Zahra, in Homs, in 1985. And unfortunately today, if you look at Zahra, it resembles nothing like what it was, let alone in 1985, what it was 5 years ago. And, you know, I do pray and hope, like many other Syrians and people affected by the conflict, that one day, not only Zahra, but all of Syria will be restored to its glory days. My son, as an idea, I'm a proud father of two boys. I have two children. One was born exactly 1 week to the day of the alleged incident in Dara, five years or so ago. So for my son, he has never known Syria to be other than what we see today or we've known Syria over the past 5 years. My father is Syrian. My father's parents, grandparents are Syrian. Many of my ancestors are Syrian. And when I talk about Syria, I know I say that my son, he doesn't know much of Syria other than what the world knows today. But again, my heart breaks for the children of Syria, those who have lived over the past 5 years and know nothing but war and crisis. In the introduction, it was mentioned that I talked a little bit about the history of Syria, both prior to and after French mandate. But it's important, I mean, in 15 minutes, it's very hard to discuss a lot of the history of Syria, so I will be as brief and precise, and I do apologise in advance if I do skip some important details. It's not done on purpose, but for the benefit of time, and obviously to give other speakers the opportunity to speak. But in reality, we can't have a discussion about Syria and its history without understanding the geopolitical influences and the history of the region and some of the Western influences that occurred not only over the past 100 years, but throughout the history of Syria. So prior to World War I, which I would say arguably is probably the first major event in our modern history, Syria was ruled by the Ottomans. It was part of the Ottoman Empire. And I don't want to spend too much time talking about the Ottoman rule, but under Ottoman rule, Syria itself, and Syria in those days, we know and we hear the term sometimes Bilad al-Sham, or we hear Greater Syria. So Syria in the time before World War I, or under Ottoman rule, was not only the Syria that we have today, but a Syria that also incorporated wholly or partially parts of Lebanon, Jordan, Palestine, and some of Iraq. So Syria itself was a far greater landmass than what we see on a world map today. But under Ottoman rule, Syria didn't prosper economically. In fact, if you look at, and I know it's a long period, 400 years, but as a general comment, Syria's economy didn't grow vastly. There was widespread poor amongst the people. The people of Syria at that time were extremely poor. And didn't have a lot of the rights which many of us are afforded today. So the Ottomans essentially picked governors, certain landowners, and did what they wanted, as well as implying upon the Syrian people high taxes, conscription, and other oppressive policies, if you like. So the rule under the Ottomans wasn't a great period for Syria itself over those 400 years. We come to World War I, and then we see that in World War I, or during World War I, we come to a policy that we know today to be Sykes-Picot. And Sykes-Picot comes about roughly in 1916. And we know that Sykes-Picot, under that agreement, the British had a sphere of influence in certain parts of the Middle East, and the French had their sphere of influence, the French mainly being on the coastal region where Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, etc. were, and the British more so inland of the Middle East, so areas encompassing Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, etc. So they come together and they decide that the Middle East would be broken up into according to their spheres. Syria itself then becomes part of the French policy or the French mandate that was to come. And we know that during that period, many of the Syrians themselves didn't want to be under French rule. And we know that throughout history there was uprisings, etc. But the reason why I guess it's important to talk about Sykes-Picot is because there's something I think that occurs today that relates to the agreement of Sykes-Picot. And that to me is that we had an Ottoman Empire who had ruled Syria for 400 years, that had exerted its influence not only on Syria, Greater Syria, but essentially over the majority of the Middle East for 400 odd years. And then all of a sudden, that power was taken from the Ottomans. Today, we have a leader of Turkey who almost himself, I think, thinks that he's trying to re-establish the power or influence of what was the Ottoman Empire 100 years or so ago. And I think there's a sour taste left in the mouth today of certain leaders around the Middle East, and not only if we're going to talk about Turkey, but I think when you look at Saudi Arabia and some of the representations and promises that were made to the British, by the British to the Saudi people at the time, the House of Saud, etc., some of those promises didn't eventuate. And you see today that it's almost as if some certain nations are almost trying to implement a Sykes-Picot version 2 in Lebanon, where they're trying to exert influence to divide and separate and claim certain parts of Syria. So after World War I, the League of Nations at the time, we know that the United Nations was about to be formed, the League of Nations decides that Syria will be put under French mandate in 1920. So during this period, we know again that the Syrian people, under the French mandate, the policies again towards Syrian people were somewhat oppressive. So some of the rights that would traditionally be afforded to citizens of the nation were not given. We know that the French in that period, and we see the best example of this today is probably Lebanon, if we look at Lebanon. If we look at the French mandate of the divide and conquer, we know that Lebanon was split politically into different groups, and we know that to be president of Lebanon today, you must be of Catholic Maronite heritage. Even though, if we look at Lebanon today, and I don't want to digress or sidetrack, but Lebanon today, as a population, I think, again, don't quote me on the numbers, but I think the majority of the population today is Muslim, whereas it may have been in the period that the mandate was given Christian. But in a nation where predominantly one sect or one religion outnumbers another, a Muslim candidate cannot assume the vision of presidency in a country where the majority of the constituents may in fact be Muslim. So after this period, so the French obviously come into Syria, they mandate for World War One. During World War One, they take over vast parts of Syria, and then we know that in World War Two or thereabouts, the French rule of Syria becomes very shaky. We know that the Syrian people themselves began to develop a sense of pride, of nationalism. The people in Syria said to themselves, we don't want to be governed by Ottomans anymore, we don't want to be governed by French, we want to be governed by ourselves. And so there was a lot of political uprising and a sense of a revolution essentially in Syria. And then in 1941, the Syrian government of the time declares independence, but it's not until 1946 that the French actually leave Syria. But during that period, we have some very famous, and you hear names, Yusuf Azma, Sheikh Saleh al-Ali, etc. You have some of these figures, revolutionary figures, who are revered in Syria as some of those who led the political and revolutionary uprising against French rule. So during this time, after 1946 or thereabouts, some history books will tell you 1947, there was some people that came together, some prominent Syrians, and Syrians from different sects, you know. So today, you know, we hear a lot about the breakdown of Syria, and we hear about Alawites and Druze and Sunni and Shia and Christians, but it's actually a Christian and a Druze figure. So they came together and they formed what's known as Hezb al-Ba'ath, or the Ba'ath Party. So it was a socialist movement, a socialist Arab movement that said, we want four things for our people. And the four main policies of the Ba'ath Party at that time were secularism, pan-Arabism, and I guess essentially freedom from Western influence, and socialism. So they were the four main objectives of the Ba'ath Party at the time. And within the Ba'ath Party, again, I don't want to spend too much time talking about the internal sort of struggles between, but there was a nationalist movement, and there was a more socialist movement, and there was two different factions within, but eventually the nationalist movement won, and that was the faction of which Hafez al-Assad belonged to. So over that time, there was some government in Syria before Hafez al-Assad took power. So in 1947, we did have a couple of attempts of government in Syria, but there was instability, so there was coup after coup, and then when Hafez al-Assad in 1970 assumes power under Ba'athist policy, new reforms and new measures, a centralized government is then formed in Syria under these four main policies, and they lay the platforms for what would be the modern day Syria, or what we know of Syria for the past 40, 45 years. So the party itself, as I said, the four main objectives were secularism, socialism, pan-Arabism, and freedom from Western influence, but they also did some